This is not an invasion of Cambodia. The areas in which these attacks will be launched are completely occupied and controlled by North Vietnamese forces. Our purpose is not to occupy the areas. Once enemy forces are driven out of these sanctuaries, and once their military supplies are destroyed, we will withdraw. We take this action not for the purpose of expanding the war into Cambodia, but for the purpose of ending the war in Vietnam and winning the just peace we all desire.
Farm.
It's so terrible. I lived with them 3 years.
3 years?
Yeah, 3 years, and they take my husband away from me like 1 year to see one time.
They separate me and her. She go to another place, I go to another place. I live in the forest. Only me, I don't want to run away because my wife pregnant, that's why I stay. But lucky, I go to sleep in the forest only 2 days.
The first time, I had twin baby. But I fell by myself, and then the baby born, and he's died, only 3 days died, both of them. When the Khmer Rouge come in, my daughter six, she have a chicken pox.
Almost 3 years old.
Then my husband go before me, and after that, my baby died, then I say, I don't want to stay alone. I want to go with him too, you know. Mm-hmm. When I come all the small river, then I see a lot of people die. Some mother die, is hurt the baby, hurt the girl. Like 8 months, and then they say they gonna move the people from Canada to Sokeo. Yeah, by the time that I go to Sokeo, about 10 days, the new camp, I born Sokeo. Then he feel healthy. When they born, they come so healthy, everybody love him. It's only the money I don't have. when Sokeo start talk and start walking, he said, "Mommy, I want to eat bread, then I don't have the money. I only have the rice." Then I can ask them to change for the bread to him eat. So I only have the rice.
Child. When I was born, my stomach was so clear that you could almost see the intestines. So that took me a long time. I was born after the name of the refugee camp called Sokeo. So they started calling me Sokeo. But I didn't get better. So they brought me to a Buddhist monk. Mind you, my family's Muslim. We're called Cham. But back at that time, the Khmer Rouge killed everyone that was different, especially the Cham people. So they took me to a monk, and he changed my name. He started calling me Vati, it was given to me for good luck. And after that, after all the blessings and the medication, finally I was getting a little bit better. Now mind you, there was no hospitals in the refugee camp. The first hospital that they had was the back of a big rig truck. You know those big rigs with 18 wheelers? That was their first hospital, and that's where I was born in. There was a lot of people who tried to buy me, but my mother would not let me go, because I was the first one to actually survive everything and made it through. We waited in the refugee camp for about 3 years. We didn't know what we were going to do. We waited to get sponsored to the United States. It just didn't happen. Until finally, we moved to the United States. California to Iowa, from Iowa to Providence, Rhode Island. Unfortunately, Providence, Rhode Island was not one of the best ones that we wanted. We moved into Hanover Street in the West End. We moved into a big, impoverished gang neighborhood. We didn't know that at the time. There were roaches, rats, transvestite prostitutes, drug dealings, chickens on one end, and a tire plastic company on the other. So we had the best of both worlds, I guess. Now in my house, it was a gang household. They were Crips at the time. I never wore red until I got out of that neighborhood. I saw one kid wear the wrong color for at the wrong time. He came down to my street, and they beat him up. I couldn't do anything. I was young. Luckily, they didn't touch me. Because my father was, he worked the night shift at the factory. They all did as well. So since my father worked there with them, he drove them when he went. So it was kind of like a barter system. You take me to work, I keep you safe. But the house, since it was a gang neighborhood, our house got shot up every other month. There are bullet holes in all the windows. There was one time where they drove a car and crashed it right into the porch, flamed up. We had an empty lot next door with an empty boat with tires and everything else that people were throwing away. They blew that up. Lemonade was the best thing for me. Only part of my childhood that I actually remember is lemonade. But we didn't have a lot of money, so lemonade back then was like a dollar. Now it's two. So what we have, the lemonade truck comes down, and it's an old school one where he actually rings the bell still. Ring, 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 ring. Came down to my block. I was one of my older folks who was going to get lemonade, but coming out without any lemonade. That truck sold hot dogs, chips, candy, soda, pretzels, lemonade, and drugs. Unfortunately, that's what we had to deal with. So my life did not change for a very, very long time. And gang life is what I got accustomed to. And that's what I stayed with. So I didn't really feel home unless I was with a bunch of gangbangers. I was never in a gang, but always a gang affiliated. And that's what kept me safe, the gangbangers. But my life did not change. It actually didn't change until I went to Everett. So I started at the age of 15 breakdancing, and I came in for my first class, and Dorothy and Therese asked me, hey, you want to do a show? No, you don't want to do a show. So after that, I kept doing show after show after show, and at the age of 18, I went on my first tour, and I was teaching master classes at the age of 18. And from then on, I kept pursuing my career and my passion, which was performance and dance and theater. I've been in 3 performing arts shows with them since 99, and this is one of them. In 2004, I started a group called Case Closed for a youth hip-hop dance program to help kids who can't, you know, do the stuff that they want to do because of black income, the way I grew up. And we've been doing shows ever since. We performed at places such as PPAC, Veterans Auditorium, the Convention Center, downtown. We've also performed in Massachusetts. In 2013, that was the first time that I actually got to go back to my own country of Cambodia. And that's the house that my mother was pushed out of. We went back to the same village that they came from. And it's the first time meeting my grandparents. That's my grandmother, and she gave me the bunny kisses that I don't know how you do. She just sniffs you. All sniffs. And I volunteered at a program to nonprofit organizations that helps kids, give them free education, arts, writing, everything that is. And this is them. So, international now, so you got that. Ever since then, I've been doing a lot of personal work story because of Everett and getting the community to tell their stories and voice their opinions and stuff as well. And one of my biggest accomplishments. So, this is actually our first family portrait ever in life. It was at my graduation. That my father actually hugged me.